All right, we'll go ahead and get started. Good afternoon, everybody. This is Allison Dvorak from Grimco's hardware software team. I wanted to thank you all for your time. We truly value your time and your business. But I wanted to take a minute and give you a little bit of background on Grimco. Grimco was actually started in 1875 as a stamp and badge company. We currently have over 50 locations in the U.S. and 7 locations in Canada. We have a wide offering of supplies and equipment. I encourage you, if you haven't already, take some time to look at our website to learn a little bit more about who we are and what we have to offer. In this session, we're actually going to go over the HP Latex Flatbed, which is the R series. We'll spend about 45 minutes on the printer, and then we'll open it up to a 15-minute Q&A session. At any time during the presentation, if you notice in the Zoom software, there's a QA section and also a chat section. We are lucky to have Tom Giulio from HP as our expert for this session that will be monitoring those, and then he will also be able to give a couple extra tips and thoughts that he has when Neil concludes the live part of the demonstration. So feel free to use those two sections, and we will answer throughout and then have that at the end. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Neil.
Thanks, Allison. Hi, everybody. My name is Neil McNamara. I'm a technician with Grimco, broadcasting to you from the Chicago Demo Center here. We have a 5,000 square foot room filled with every piece of equipment, hardware, software option that Grimco has to offer. Before we get started about the R1000, I want to take just a second and tell you a little bit about myself. I worked for a print shop for many, many years that had a phenomenal relationship with Grimco. That's how I got to know all the team really well here. They helped us out with all of our substrates, medias, as well as the hardware software that we use to run our business. And they kept us in the loop of all the latest, greatest advancements, and we were able to really kind of keep the business growing along forward with the help of Grimco. A few things transpired over time, and I wound up leaving that business and to pursue some other aspects of our industry. And then I heard about this opportunity available at the Grimco Demo Center and was more than ecstatic to come and join the team as one of the technicians who runs the Demo Center on a daily basis. It's a phenomenal facility, 5,000 square feet, some of the world's finest printing equipment available. One of the most great things about this setup here is we're attached to a 100,000 square foot distribution facility just here in the suburbs of Chicago. So let's go ahead and jump right into the R1000 series and get it going, show you guys all the bells and whistles that come along with this machine. So I thought it was only appropriate, since we're in an election year, that I'm going to go ahead and start this demonstration off with a demonstration of printing yard signs. It's a staple in our industry, and it's a boom this year especially. So I went ahead and used the front panel of the R1000 here. It's a nice, easy, that's probably not going to show up really well on your guys' screen. So nice, easy features, all done with a touch screen. So now it's asking me to go ahead and load my first substrate. I'm using the pin alignment so I can print multiple sheets up at the same time. I can also feed an entire sheet at once in the machine. So I already dropped my pin down into a prescribed location. I set my spacer here. Now that I'm ready, my material's loaded, ready to go, I'm going to come back to the front panel and hit feed. I can also hit feed from the machine itself here. And there's an optional foot pedal that can be moved anywhere along. So if your workflow requires you to stand further back to load full sheets in, you can have this foot pedal all the way back there and just keep loading sheets being further away from the machine. In any event, I'm going to go ahead and hit feed on my machine here. So it's going to load the substrate into the mouth of the R1000. The R1000 is a 60... It has a 64-inch wide belt that it can print on. And this is a hybrid roll-to-roll flatbed printer. So that allows you to print on rigid substrates as well as roll-to-roll feature using the section down below. I'm going to cover that in a little bit. I just thought I'd mention it right now. Different than a traditional flatbed where the substrate's going to remain in place and the printheads are going to move across the substrate, the printheads remain in place and the substrate feeds through. That's what makes it a hybrid flatbed. Okay, so it's fully read my material, knows what's loaded inside there. All my position, my measurement, width and length is preset in here for me, so I hit done with my printing process. I'm going to go to my work queue section and drag 4 copies of this yard sign that I want to print in here. Tell me everything's communicating well, ready to print. and I go ahead and hit print. So one of the neat features, what I'm going to try to demonstrate for you, is it has a continuous production method. So I queued this up for 4 yard signs I want to print right now. All I have is 2 substrates loaded right now. It's going to enter those into the print zone, start printing them, and then when the when it's reached a certain point, it's ready for the next substrate. It'll cue me, alert me, hey, go ahead and load your next substrate. I don't need to wait for the machine to finish printing before I can load my next sheet in there. And this can keep, I can print a 1,000 copies of this yard sign on 24 by 18 blanks, and it'll just keep asking for more material as it's ready to go. So the machine's gonna take a minute to come up to temperature. This is a HP latex machine, which means the ink is cured via heating process. So right now what's happening is you got heating elements inside the leading part of the machine and heating elements in the end of the machine. All those are coming up to temperature. Make sure it's at a solid state before it starts laying down ink. I don't know if you guys can see it well from this. I am going to go ahead and move the, I'm going to move around to the other side so you can see this thing printing. One of the most difficult aspects of being able to demonstrate this, this large of a machine is moving cameras around to multiple locations. But I got a bunch of camera changes happening here, and you will be able to see the print side of the machine in just a few minutes. So like I said, this is the R1000. They also have the R2000. The R2000 has a 98-inch wide conveyor belt. So if I was going to print a 4x8 sheet, I could print that horizontally, printed the length, the longer part of the ways. Kind of a unique unique aspect of it. So we go from a 64 to a 98. The outside chambers of those machines don't change at all. So the overall width of your machine for the 2000 versus the 1000 only changes by the width of what your belt is. It's a pretty small size footprint for what you're getting with the capabilities of the machine. Okay, so now my prints are underway. This is a yard sign, but at the same time, I don't like to produce poor looking work. This one has some nice color to it. So I'm printing this at a 3-pass, 70% ink density. This is a 6-color machine, so CMYK, light cyan, light magenta. The HP Latex has a completely different configuration of their ink settings, especially with this machine. It's configured with a white layer, which is phenomenal. Not printing anything white right now, but it has 2 channels of optimizer. Optimizer is a positively charged particle that holds those ink droplets in place until they can go through the curing zone of this machine and become solidified and instantly dry. It also has an overcoat channel added to it. Different than what the roll-to-roll technology that HP Latex has. On this machine, they added a whole additional channel of overcoat to give it increased scratch resistance, and it's going to protect the life of the ink on a hard substrate. Okay, so you can see my light's all lit up for me. It's asking me to load some more substrate. I actually think I missed my cue. Slow things down a little bit, but it'll wait for me. So I just go ahead and set my things in there. It dropped down the alignment bar. I turn on the light here. That lets me know that's my indicator. Hey, this thing's ready to go. I set my material in here, lift my spacer bar up, let it know, hey, substrate's ready. It's going to flash, and now it's going to start drawing that yard sign into there and run the next set of this prints. So I'm going to go ahead and change camera angles in just a second here so I can show you what it's going to look like while it's printing. Let's buzz on over there. And this is inside the print zone. So right now the carriage, you just saw it off to the right, does a quick little check in between prints. You can see start to see my substrate pop out here. I'll try not to make this too shaky. Had a couple cups of coffee this morning though. So. All right, and there's the yard sign starting to appear. There's my print head carriage getting ready to start laying down some ink. And it travels the entire width of the platen, comes across. And so it's laying down, I know it's probably not going to show up really well in this camera angle, but I could see it with my bare eyes. It's laying down that optimizer layer before it lays down ink on here. And then after it lays down the ink, it's following behind and laying down a layer of the overcoat, which is going to give it the scratch resistance. You can see it printing there. Let's go ahead and switch back to the wide angle. Right, and already my first signs are out of the machine, ready to go. My kids really love the Mandalorian and the Disney Plus channel. Can't get enough of it. So we're really hoping this this campaign winds up gaining some traction. They'd love nothing more than see Baby Yoda take a position. So hope that was fun. So I'm going to go ahead and load another substrate for you. So the R1000 also comes up with optional roller feed tables. So if you're doing a lot of sheet feed, this is a necessary option. Very solid, solid, well-built tables. They have nice leveling feet to it, so you can be at the exact same height. You're keeping everything level with the pace of the machine. Lock in both sides here. While I'm talking about the roller tables, probably be a good chance to now talk about the options available with the R1000, R1000 and R2000. They have a what's called a plus feature that gives you the base model. I'm sorry. I'll try to reiterate. I'm sure maybe Tom can clear this up after the discussion. I'll do my best right now, though. So the R1000 and R2000 are sold as base models. Everything else is add-on pieces. So the roll-to-roll feature, the tables, and the ability to print white ink are add-on features. HP provides basic training with the installation of the machine. There's advanced training that they can supply, too. If you order the plus model of this machine, it includes the roll-to-roll, the tables, the white ink capabilities, and some other features that I'm spacing or glancing over right now. So there are two different pricing options for both the R1000 and the R2000, and that's the plus model. Got to move my spacer pin out of the way. So now I'm going to load up a 4x8 sheet of PVC onto here. Wait till those yard signs are complete. So I'm not exactly sure how long this this video has been going on for now, but in the matter of just a few minutes, I was able to produce four amazing yard signs. It could have kept going. There was some downtime that I could have kept feeding machines in there. But that's a pretty impressive production speed for just PVC blanks that are fed in. So I'm going to go back to my front panel here, and now I'm choosing a different material type. Until that, I'm going to shoot PVC. There we are. Alram PVC. And I got to click to auto measure. So it's going to go ahead and run through its entire process. Hit the load button here. And this is where that that foot pedal would come into handy. I keep mine up there because I don't run a production so much here in the demo center. It's a lot of one-off productions. But if you were in a full-blown production mode, that having that foot pedal movable is definitely going to help out with some of your workflow solutions. So I press my material against my alignment bar, lift up my spacer block on the side, and I'm going to go ahead and hit feed. And just like the core plastic blanks, it's going to pull it into the machine, get a measurement of the height, get a measurement of the width, know where it's located on that belt, and then let me know we're ready to print. So this is a good workflow scenario. I talked about that foot pedal. If I had a pallet full of this PVC, this loading process, once I've gotten the first sheet loaded and set, you know, figured out the height, the width, where it's positioned, so long as I'm loading that same substrate, I can turn off that auto measure feature, and it knows so long as I keep it right, and I'm loading the exact same sheet over and over again, it probably cuts down that process by about a minute and a half. So we're all loaded up there. Let me go ahead and just go through my work queue here and find it. The file that I want to run. So PowerRAM PVC, everything's all good. I'm getting no warnings that there's incompatibilities. I go ahead and hit print, continue through here, and now we're going to run. So now this print, slowed it down a little bit more. HP latex technology is kind of a combination of three factors. Okay, you have your ink density, so the amount of ink you're trying to put down, with your temperature, which is kind of dictated by the substrate you're printing on, followed by the speed at which you run. Okay, so the speed is indicated by the passes. Ink density, everyone can understand that. It's a percentage-based system. And then temperature. This PVC has a certain thermal temperature at which it will not deform, and it's going to be able to take that ink. So if I need to pick up my ink density, I'm going to need to either turn up my temperature or I'm going to need to lower my ink density so that the PVC can print without thermal deforming. It's kind of a switch between those kind of three factors come into play. PVC, I want to get a really nice, vibrant print. This is going to be a product that a customer is going to be able to hold in their hands and look at, 6 inches away from their face. So I want the richest resolution I have. So rather than a yard sign, it's going to be viewed at some distance. I printed that at 3 pass. I slowed this one down a little bit, printing at 4 pass, 90% ink density. So just a slight tweaking in that formula, that triangulation of speed, temperature, and ink density is what allows us to make the determining factors for what we're going to print. So while this is printing, I'm going to go ahead and tell you a little bit about some of the easy features. So like I was just describing kind of the combination of the print pass ink density profiles. All of this information is available through HP's Print OS system. It's a cloud-based application that covers everything relating to the latex printers. There's a knowledge center. I can almost promise you everything I just said about how understanding that formulation of print pass and ink density came from the HP Knowledge Center. There's an unlimited amount of videos available on that Print OS to help you kind of understand how the system works. Additionally, Print OS is a great way connected to the operating system inside my actual machine to give me real-time data, the amount of ink usage used, how many in the course of a month, how many of each substrate I print on. There's a whole bunch of data, how many hours this machine spent being productive. It alerts you to any ink issues. Like this machine itself has had I have a system warning going on here right now, letting me know I'm low on overcoat. We're going to get into the ink system a little bit more, but all of that information can be linked with Print OS and it's accessible from a laptop, any internet-based thing. They also connect a lot with mobile devices. So I can have a system that kind of customize the alert so that it lets me know when things are going on with my machine. So if I want to let this machine run unattended, but still know that, hey, it's doing what I set it out to do. Say I string up a roll of decal that I want to run overnight, or a whole roll of banner, and I want to get an alert if this thing starts to run out of ink. That Print OS system enables it to happen. So let's go ahead and switch over to the Handycam again, and I'll show you the inside of the machine while this is printing. All right, so you can see we're about halfway through. I got some nice guitars printing on this PVC that I'm going to pull over to my flatbed cutter a little later and go ahead and cut those up on my ESCO flatbed. So a little slower speed, the 4 pass versus 3 pass, probably not that noticeable. Again, the beauty of the R2000 is this 4x8 sheet would be flipped in the other orientation, and that print head would be moving all the way across, printing the entire length of the 4x8 sheet. So there's a system inside this machine called an OBAS, O-B-A-S. It's an optical belt advanced sensor, and that's what allows the HP machine to have such a great registration where it syncs up the head movement with the advancement of the belt. That's what allows the continuous production. It allows the roll-to-roll feature to happen fairly seamlessly. So I'm going to go ahead and switch back to my wide-angle view. All right. Set my camera up here for a minute. This camera doesn't fall. All right, and so you can see I got a corresponding outfeed table on the other side. So there's four tables all together. These tables, really nice heavy-duty caster wheels, a nice adjustment on the bottom. Not everybody's shop floor is perfectly level. I was surprised to find our floor has some waviness to it. It looks nice and level. But this way, you get a perfect feed of your material coming out of your machine as well as going into your machine. When these tables aren't in use, the whole attachment flips up on its side. They can be tucked away in a corner nice and easy. They do make phenomenal work tables for a million different tasks. I feel guilty sometimes the amount of times that I use these tables for other tasks besides printing on the R-Series. But they're large tables that are easy to fold out of the way and kind of multi-purpose tables as well. So we're just going to go ahead and let this run. I assume that's the reason everybody tuned in today. They wanted to actually see this equipment run. While that's going, I'm going to talk about, it doesn't really show really well on this screen, but I'm going to talk about some of the options available. If you notice, I have these dual monitor panels on both sides. Sorry, I can't show them at the same time. But I can do reach all essential functions from either side of the machine. Really nice. So as I'm here with as an operator, I can check out, okay, here's where my ink levels are. That overcoat ink level, we're at 2%. I really should pay attention to those numbers. It's going to run out one of these days when I'm not here. I'll have to keep an eye on that one. But you can hot swap these bulk cartridges. You can change it out on the fly. So I'm going to let that thing run down all the way down to zero and swap it out when needed. But it's given me an indication of my print heads installed in the machine, how everything is going. You're able to kind of toggle between a couple different screens. I know that doesn't show really well. One thing we're going to get into in a little bit is the print system, the ink delivery system on this machine. And I'll hopefully cover that as well as possible. But to really access any of those systems right now, I got to wait till the machine finishes printing. Something to discuss is the maintenance options of this machine, or the maintenance of this machine to keep it printing well. There's a lot of well-built internal systems that take place. I'm going to open up the guts of this machine, lift the hood, and you can see some of the things that are going on there. But this touchscreen panel, because it's such an interactive, it's got its own processing unit in there, they're able to provide you with detailed instructions on how to go about the routine maintenance on these things. There's maintenance features that pop up on a daily, weekly, monthly, yearly, periodic level. And each one of those tasks has detailed instructions step-by-step of what you need to do to go through it. Few minutes every day spent doing the tasks. It keeps your machine running optimally. There's a lot of things that happen in the background where you're completely even hands off and it's wiping it. I don't know how good the sound is, but each time the print head goes across, you hear kind of like a I don't know if you guys can hear that on the audio I got going on now. There's little squeegees that go across a paper towel, essentially, and it's wiping the overspray of those print heads off each time. We'll get into some more the beauty of this printhead carriage system once I open the hood. Just another minute or so for this print to finish. You know, one thing I want to touch on, since we got a minute to spare, PVC, acrylic. Remember I talked about the heat sensitivity, the heat drying nature of the machine. Most of your curing happens right here in this zone. There is air that's blown this way into the print zone, but that's where you got to be worried about your material starting to buckle and coming into contact with your head as it goes across. This little lever here will turn off or turn on flaps that allow the heat to go. So because this was a heat sensitive or heat critical substrate, it thermally deforms pretty easily. I had these flaps closed, which prevented the heat from going into there. So there's a little heat inducted early in the print zone to kind of bring the temperature up, to bring the material up to temperature so it receives that ink and the ink can kind of sink into that substrate and bite into that substrate. I can turn the heat off in the middle when it's in the print zone, which kind of lets the material cool back down. It doesn't add any more heat that's going to buckle the material up. And then the bulk of the heat comes right here in this curing zone. So the fan and the heater is directed right down on top of the material, which at the end of the day, that's what gives us our scratch resistant properties of the ink printed directly to a substrate. As opposed to say a UV cured where the ink is laying down and lights are following ahead, you know, kind of a shutter on off with the shutters. That's how the HP Latex ink is cured directly onto a substrate. So I'm gonna go ahead and move this over to my flatbed, chop this up in a little bit. And there we have it. So I'm gonna go ahead and switch over. One of the great features of this machine is its ability to print white. Far above any other machine I've ever worked with as far as the white layer capabilities on this thing. Again, it's a channel of color. There's adjustability. So if you need 100% white, go ahead. 120%, 260. It's an adjustable layer of white. It has undercoat or overcoat. So you can lay down the white layer first on top of your substrate with color on top, or lay color down and then white on top. It also has a sandwich mode where it can lay, say I'm printing on reverse print on some clear acrylic. I can lay down color, a layer of white, and then a layer of color on the top side of the acrylic, reverse printed. So when I hold it up, you're seeing acrylic on the surface. you know, nobody's going to be able to get to it. This would be a great application for a wall where you wanted to have a standoff project. The ink is behind the layer of acrylic. And say you wanted to be able to display it double-sided. I don't know how you would do that with a standoff project. But there's a lot of capabilities with that sandwich mode. It even has the capability of laying down a layer of color, layer of white, a black layer in between to cause a blockout, another layer of white, another layer of color. So that's a 5-layer sandwich mode. It's phenomenal. And it's all because the substrate is advanced while it's laying down the color. So it could not move it, lay down a patch, lay down another patch. It times it out to where the ink is able to saturate that substrate. So let me go ahead and open up the cover on this thing and show you the insides. So like I was talking about, the amazing ability to print white on this machine is great. And you're not wasting or purging white ink to keep it live in the system, okay? So I'm gonna show you in real time how easy it is to change out the white print heads on this, but let's go ahead and cover what's going on inside this carriage. So you have not one, but two crash sensors listed here and another one listed here behind the carriage. And so if something's happening with my substrate and it started to warp, I thought I had my settings right, these crash sensor bars are gonna kick over and it's gonna prevent my expensive head, you know, this will just shut it down. And then I gotta retweak my profile a little bit and get things going. So then you'll see, first part in the carriage is that optimizer. So that optimizer is that positively charged particle that's gonna drop down on the substrate before the ink comes in there, and it's gonna give it that bonding adhesion property. It's gonna hold that ink in place until it can cure to gain that proper bonding and adhesion properties. This OC, this is my overcoat layer, and then my standard, black, cyan, light magenta, yellow, magenta, and then I have not one, but two white printheads. Right now, though, those white printheads are not inside that carriage. There is a dummy printhead put in here that just is a placeholder while my white printheads are sitting in their storage tank, keeping them nice and fresh. So I'm able to keep this system fully charged. My lines have white ink in them, but my printheads are non-existent. So I'm able to keep the system fully charged, and all I have to do is swap out my printheads and I can start printing with white. So I'm gonna go ahead and pull this one aside. I will pan back to a wide view and show you guys the ink storage system. Just didn't want to give you too much of a shaky cam experience. All right, and here I am with the print head for number one position. So now this is a full, here's my jets down below, nozzles down below. So you can see redundancy in all the print heads. So if I have one or two nozzles out, you're not going to notice a single difference. The machine actually runs through its own process where it checks to make sure all your printhead nozzles are firing correctly. Quick little slide it in. And you'll notice one thing else. These printheads are replaceable. Simple matter of pulling out all the other printheads, come out exactly like these white ones are interchangeable with the dummy printheads. There we are. And pulling out the dummy for ink set number two. This one's a little trickier to slide in, but let me see if I can get it without looking too cumbersome. With it being so far back inside the carriage, this top part doesn't slide in so easy, but a little more finagling and then it happens. There we go. All right, press it into place, lock it back down. And that's it. I gotta close this up, do a quick finishing check. But any one of these other printheads, say my magenta yellow, I did a check and clean and it just wasn't recovering the nozzles. You know, over the lifetime of this machine, and any large format printer for that matter, your print heads have the potential of going out on you. With the HP Latex, it makes it user serviceable replacement. It's just a matter of pulling that print head out, putting a new print head in there. You know, hopefully I can recover that print head and get a little more life out of it. But at some point you're going to have to move on and replace those print heads. HP Latex allows the user to serve that rather than waiting, you know, a couple weeks for a tech to be able to come out, replace the entire printhead system. It's replaceable cartridges. So real quick, while I got you here, I want to show these large towers here. You got two of them. Like I said, over on this side, you have the optimizer. It's blocked by the tower right now. Optimizer is that positively charged particle. So if there's any overspray from the optimizer, we want it on the material. We don't want it to go on the rest of the printheads over here. So HP put an aerosol tower in between the optimizer carriage or the optimizer printheads and the rest of your printheads. So this aerosol cartridge, it's just a simple air filter in here. This is one of the regular maintenance tasks. I believe it's a monthly task, is cleaning the underside of this, cleaning out, and then eventually replacing that filter altogether. But that aerosol filter is drawing air from your print zone up and out of the machine. And so that's what keeps your print carriage nice and clean. And then you saw the other tower that we have on the right-hand side of the print heads. So, okay, so let's go ahead and close this up, and then I'll switch back to my my wide view. Okay, so we're all good. The next step, I go right here, and I need to tell it, hey, I'm replacing these print heads. And everything's all set. I'm going to hit finish and check. All right, if I can zoom in, let me move this camera out of the way. Set this up for the later shot I got for you, got planned for you. So now at this point, the machine's going through its automated process. We'll open that up as soon as I show you this press. These are my dummy print heads here. Let me zoom in on it real quick. So you can see there's no print nozzles on this at all. It's basically the input and output for the ink inside my system. This sits inside this nice strong metal box, little storage container. Lock this other one up real quick. Is anyone running a timer of how long it took me to get my white ink printing? And then I'm going to take this and put it inside its carriage. So let me go ahead and switch to my handy cam view so you can see what I'm seeing inside the inside of the machine. There we are. Okay, I'll bring it in close and then pull it back out. So here, this device here is where my ink cartridges are going to store. Right now it's just dummy cartridges, but I need a place to put the boxes. And then this device, every 20 minutes, is going to rotate 190 degrees. And so what that does is that keeps my printheads constantly cycling the ink that is left inside the printhead so that it never dries out, always stays fresh. So when I put them into my machine, the nozzles are going to fire just fine. Let me take you guys into shaky mode again. So part of the check and clean process, it's going across the two, remember I said there was wipers that the printhead goes across. Goes across the two wipers, one's for the color and the optimizer level. And then, hopefully we'll get to it in a second, this tray here in the middle is going to come forward. Here it goes. See that light just turned on? So that's got an array of some lasers, and that's going to do basically a drop detection on the white inks, make sure everybody's firing just fine. And if it's got too many print heads clogged where it's going to show up visibly on the print, it's going to alert me to it, and I could take some other. You can see the ink spraying. Hope you guys can see that okay. I really hope this is displaying okay. It's hard for me to see both. But this is the beauty of the system, that it is able to self-check its print health, let you know you're good. It's a lot easier than running half a board through there and realizing you're having a print quality issue going on. There's a lot of redundancy built into the nozzles on this machine. So that if it's missing one, it compensates for and fires from others. Keep the machine printing well. All right, let's pull back a little bit. And it's telling me, hey, everything's printing good. It's finishing up the replacement of it. Looks like everything's checking out. So if it was running through problems while I was doing that process, we'll go ahead and switch back to the wide angle view. So if it recognized that there were some problems there, it would automatically go into another cleaning cycle, get itself nice and clean. It's gonna alert me everything going along. So yeah, it says, hey, print heads were successfully replaced. And so now I'm fully ready to print with white ink. Oh, there we go. And that's it. I'm going to go ahead and take my camera around to the other side and show you the ink supply system of this machine. There we are. And we'll switch over to that. Let's see if I can get that nice and framed well. All right, not too shabby. So this machine comes with these 3-liter bulk ink boxes. Okay, this is similar to the HP Latex 570 bulk ink system. Identical process of how the system works. So you buy your boxes in bulk systems. Inside the machine, there are the 775 milliliter cartridges that are replenished from these bulk boxes. So the main ink supply goes to the intermediate cartridge, and the intermediate cartridge is what feeds my head. The whole system is kind of under pressure, so to be able to take it from the bulk box, fill in an intermediate tank, and then be able to feed that ink supply system into the printheads. It's a much better system, keeps it simple, delivers a steady supply of ink with no interruptions. So you'll notice I got black cyan, light magenta, light cyan. Here is my overcoat protection, and here is my optimizer level. Down here in the lower left is my white capability. Something unique about the white is that it's got two ports. And so this is so that the entire system is allowed to circulate that white ink through there, and that white ink stays fresh. It doesn't, the materials used to make the opacity of the white ink don't separate out from each other. So it's constantly circulating my white ink, even if I'm not printing white ink. You saw how the whole printhead system comes out and maintains its health. This is how the health of the entire system of white ink is allowed to circulate. It's a pretty innovative, the simplicity of the system is what makes it so ingenious in my opinion. So, okay, we'll go ahead and switch back over to the main wide angle view. I'm gonna walk around to the other side of this machine here. So I'm gonna go ahead and demonstrate the roll-to-roll feature on this machine. I'm gonna disconnect my tables. All right, pull that back. All right, and before I jump too much into the roll-to-roll, I wanna show that there is another option for loading this machine. They come with these, there we go, basically a track roller system that fits on top of my tables, and I can do what's called tabletop load, where I can put a roll of banner, there's two of them. Probably makes more sense if you see them both, right? So I can put a roll of material, a roll of self-adhesive vinyl, any kind of roll media, right onto here, have this attached to the table, and feed that into my machine and print. So if I wasn't doing an entire long run, I wasn't gonna print an entire roll, say I'm gonna print one banner, two banners, I can use this tabletop load to load that one run. Longer runs, though, you're going to want to use the actual roll-to-roll to take up real end supply so that it maintains the skew, maintains the position of your banner over time. So speaking of which, the roll-to-roll option on this machine is by far one of the beefiest, most well-built take-up systems I've ever seen. So it's a geared system, nice thick solid bar that goes in here. And the really cool feature to me is the rubber blades, for lack of a better term, that run through this thing are air activated. It doesn't take much. I got a little shop air compressor, 80 PSI. You put the inlet valve on here. Let's see if you guys can hear the noise. And that's what fills it up. So I take my little shop compressor, and it expands those blades around there, and it locks this roll in position. So I just let all my air out, so now I actually have to go fill it up again. It's also got a really nice, pretty sure the camera is not gonna pick this up, so that I can make sure I position my roll in the middle of my belt. It's got a tape measure built into the whole side. You divide the width of your roll in half, and then set that in that position. Makes it really easy to get a nice straight run. Corresponds with what's on the take-up reel side too, so I can make sure my supply and my take-up are nice and even with each other. Eliminates any possibility for skewing. Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and pull up some material here. Hold that there for a second. Go back over to my load function. Whoop. I got to change it. I was doing sheet feed. Now I'm going to do roll feed. Auto position measure. There we are. So what I'm loading up here is Brightline clear static cling. I got my white ink cartridges in there. I'm gonna run some amazing prints with the okay. And so now it's gonna advance that belt a little bit. And this helps me get a nice even skew across the front. It's gonna turn on the vacuum. It's got a very smart vacuum system. It's underneath the belt. So it held the vacuum, turned the vacuum on, and now it's pulling my material through there. Just like when I loaded the sheets up, it's gonna go ahead and drop down that bar, know where things are, know exactly what it's gonna print on. Okay, we are good to go. All right, and so now I'm ready to start printing on white. So I thank everybody for the demonstration. I hope this was helpful, gave you a little insight into the R1000. There's any other questions? I guess we'll open it up now for questions. Oops. Allison, you with me?
I'm here, Neil. How are you doing?
Hey, this is Tom. Hey, Tom, how are you doing?
Hey, good. Hey, I was watching everything. Great job, by the way.
Thank you.
You were certainly multitasking today, so we appreciate that. Hey, just a couple things. Sarah had asked a question. If you wouldn't mind, could you just show how easy it is to fold down one of the tables?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Let me get this out of my way real quick.
Yeah, we wanted to do that before we got into a couple things. But you have one set, one table is the in-feed and one is the out-feed that comes with every model. And you can see the bigger table, there's a set of two that are additional. Yeah. They come with the plus units, but for the base model, you just get the two. And this is how easy it is. There's a cable underneath the table, and then you pull the cable, and then it tilts out of the way and it's on casters. All the tables have what we call spirit levels built into them. The tables can be leveled just by adjusting some levers underneath the table to keep them nice and straight. And then each table has what we call a cone and a bushing. And the cone and the bushing allows the tables to be universal. So that was one of them. We had another question about print heads. And wanted to explain that the printhead architecture on this machine basically has three SKUs. It has one SKU for the white, one SKU for the optimizer. So, and one SKU for all the, so for all the colors. It has, sorry about that. Some emergency call came through my phone. But anyway, it has three SKUs. So you have white ink print heads, you have optimizer print heads, and the overcoat and the color is one single SKU. So you don't have to stock a particular color print head on the shelf. So they become assigned to the printer channel once they go in. So just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, you're right. I did kind of breeze over that. Thanks, Tom.
Yeah, it's okay.
See, that's why I'm glad to have you online. There's so much going on with this machine.
Always another set of eyes. And then one of the other things was the service options. I took a note of that. And I don't want to take your time from showing your samples.
I thought I'd kill some time with the visuals. This is just some amazing representations of the white capabilities. And so this is black PVC. This is just white on that same black PVC. But you can just see how vibrant those colors come out. And again, completely scratch resistant. You know, this is definitely something you could just ship out to your customer. You're going to damage the substrate before you scratch the ink off.
And we have customers actually that have printers that are upwards of $1 million, and they end up buying one or two R series printers just to print white. Just shows how easy it is and how good it is. We can't underscore that enough. Service options. I just wanted to go through that real quick. It's one of the nice things about HP is the fact that the service options are really up to you. With the plus units, you get 18 months warranty right from HP. It's HP direct service. For 18 months, and that's bumper to bumper on the whole machine. The base unit, you get 12 months with that, with the base unit, but 18 for the plus units. Now, after that warranty expires, you have the option of getting trained and to do it yourself if you want to. If you feel like you're capable to do that, you would pay about $2,500 US to come to HP for a week in Atlanta when we reopen that back up. And you'll take a four-day class that will teach you how to really kind of become an HP tech on this particular device. You can, there's four plans. They range from $700 a month to $1,900 a month. I know I really didn't want to talk about prices, but those are list prices. You can talk to your Grimco rep about those, but it gives you the range where you can either do a parts and remote plan, which is kind of the bare bones plan where you can buy all the parts and fix it yourself. You can do a shared maintenance where we'll get you all the access you need, plus a couple visits from HP during the course of a year. You can go into a full service where it's all on HP to fix it. And then you can go into what we call like a Cadillac plan, which is a full service extended, where anything that the printer will ever need in terms of like 100,000 mile tune-ups, we call them service maintenance kits, that pricing for the labor and for the parts would all be included. So again, best thing is to talk to your Grimco rep because they have the pricing for all these. They have the detailed list of the benefits, okay? And then they have all the discounts too that that can be passed along. So yeah, four things. And Neil, I appreciate you explaining those earlier, but I just wanted to add a little bit of context to those.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much. I wouldn't have explained it as well as you did.
Two questions that came in. I was typing as fast as I could when you were talking, but two questions I didn't answer. Jeff asked, what about edge guards for the roll-to-roll option? Do you want to take that one or?
I honestly don't have, we didn't okay. get, when we got our machine here, we didn't go with the edge guard system in here. I do know okay. they're available. The one tech, the HP tech that was here for one of the training installation processes says he's seen them. They work really well. He goes, most of the time you don't need it. The intelligent vacuum system really doesn't knit.
Right.
And that's a necessity.
Same thing I was going to say. Really, you don't need the edge guards. If you're printing heavy volumes of corrugated for packaging, or you have, you know, extruded plastic that comes really wavy from your manufacturer, you might want to get the edge guards. But like Neil said, if you're really good with your settings, you're really not going to need them. The edge guards are available. I'll show you how to access what they look like. But they're very expensive. So you got to make sure that you need those. I'll throw a question to you that again just came in. Do you laminate on the substrates that you put through the flatbed? So I'll throw that back at you and you can answer that one if you don't mind.
I would say completely unnecessary. You know, with my nice beard, I am probably the worst person at running things through a laminator. It seems no matter how hard I try, I wind up with beard hair all the time. So if I can avoid laminating something, I do. It's the scratch resistant added onto the surface of this through the HP ink doesn't really require lamination. You okay. know, if you were doing, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Great. That last question here that we can take for a second is, are we going to make any comments on printing soft hand fabrics with this latex printer? So either you or Menia, whatever you want to do on this one.
Yeah, I mean, like I touched on earlier, the HP roll-to-roll does a phenomenal job on fabrics because of the pliability of the ink. You know, it takes to a textured fabric real well. It gives a nice soft feel as opposed to like a UV ink or a solvent ink that'll just kind of wash into the fabric and its off-gassing process. Latex ink lays down the ink, puts it exactly where you want it to get a nice crisp image, but then it's soft and pliable once it's fully cured and it's able to move with the fabric. The hybrid feature of the R series, it performs the exact same as the roll-to-roll fabrics.
Yeah, so this is an interesting one. So there are lots of things that you can print on this printer. And, you know, we always want to tell you it can print on anything. But in reality, the only thing you can't print with this is a porous textile. So if you have a textile that has any kind of any kind of holes in it, like an open weave nylon, or you have a mesh that doesn't have a liner, those are the things you can't print with this printer, because then the ink would be shooting through the belt. On our other latex platforms, the 300 series, the 500 series, well, actually the 365 and the 500 series to be accurate, those have ink collectors. So we can shoot the ink through the media and we can collect it, you know, nice and responsibly. Here we can't do that. The ink would print on the belt. We don't want to, I mean, even though you can get ink on the belt, you just don't want to make a practice of getting, you know, volumes of it.
Too much ink on the belt, eventually you're going to clog up that vacuum system and prevent it to, like when I printed these yard signs, I was able to print complete edge to edge. You print it full bleed and it lets it print over just a little bit. I ran a couple versions of it, so I'm barely putting any ink onto my belt. But at the same time, I don't want any white around the edges of my material. So a little bit of belt cleaning, and that's a regular, it's a fairly hard coated belt. It's a metal with a coated plastic over the top of them, right, Tom?
That's nylon.
Or nylon. Okay.
Yeah.
It does, like you can see, we can zoom in a little close. You can see my belt has been printed on a little bit. We did some already cut cornhole boards, and we ran the first two through without thinking, but the place where the hole was, now I have a permanent mark on my belt until we filled that hole with a piece of cardboard so that we weren't spraying full bleed onto my belt.
Yeah, and you know, backing up what Neil said about the ink, and I answered this question. We talked about ink thickness in one of the questions I answered today. And, you know, when you're talking about UV, you know, you're printing in thousands of millimeters, called microns. And a UV typically is anywhere 15, 20, 25 microns thick. And we're sitting at about 3 or 4 in normal application. So the yard sign that he just printed at 70% ink density, he is probably at 3 microns of ink. He can't feel any difference in texture between a non-printed area and a printed area. So when you do print on those soft hand fabrics, you're not gonna feel it. It's gonna be just like it was in the fabric. So
it does need to be a coated fabric, not an uncoated porous fabric that you're gonna bleed through. Right.
Right. So Sean asked if we have an example, and just Sean, call your Grimco rep and they'll work to get you one. There was a question about accounting, and Neil talked about PrintOS. It's our ecosystem. Yep, go ahead.
PrintOS system. No, you go ahead, Tom.
I'll give you the next one. That's a trick question.
Gotcha.
Does the printer have an accounting feature like other latex printers? And, you know, what's the rough cost on printing signs? And again, I'm trying to stay away from costs here. Just to make it kind of generic, but the system does have an accounting feature, and you can tell, how much everything is included. And one thing I just wanted to underscore is the fact that when we quote, and when Grimco quotes, ink cost, we are talking consumption. We are talking end-to-end consumption. So all the things that we had shown you today with the roll, the maintenance roll, the print heads, anything that is part of the process is a consumable, and we include that in our ink cost. So, you know, in rough roundabout way, you're probably at 10 or 11 cents a square foot for what he did today, probably maybe even a little less, because you did that at 70%, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so it's probably a little less than that. But anyway, if anyone wonders what the ink costs are, you can get your samples printed from your Grimco rep, and they can tell you. I'll throw this one at you, Neil. What is the minimum surface energy needed to develop optimum print quality when printing on polymeric films?
Now you stumped me, Tom.
Okay, I told you about that question. Surface energy, you know, a lot of people talk about surface energy when you're printing on polypropylenes, polyethylenes, polymeric types of film. And UV typically has a lot of issues over the course of the evolution of UV with adhesion. This ink, the adhesion is exceptionally good. Neil talked about the optimizer earlier today. And the optimizer actually is a cationic agent that gives us the ability to adhere to a lot of these films where they never could before with UV. So the technical answer is we can effectively print and cure with good durability, probably in the neighborhood of 20 dynes per square centimeter. So if that's a technical answer, you can always shoot that to Neil, and Neil, you and I can work on that customer, but that's the technical answer to it.
Absolutely.
That dumps the queue. That dumps the queue, and I think we're tight on time. But I just wanted to say great job to the Grimco team. This is really cool. It's funny how when you're kind of working, under the conditions, we find a good way to do things. Here's one question that came in, and I'll shoot this to you, Neil. This should be good. Any issues with double-sided corrugated printing as it relates to board warp due to heat, especially in large solid prints like the one you're holding?
Yeah, no, absolutely. There is no issue at all. I mean, this was printed double-sided. It can come out, especially if you're doing a larger sheet of corrugated, it'll come out and it'll kind of be bent up a little bit. You give it a few minutes and that board just settles back down. The latex ink is flexible. It's a bendable media as opposed to UV. You're going to feel the surface and scratching of it. Latex is as flexible as your substrate is. So during the heating process, you can get a little bit of I wouldn't say warping. It's not even warping. Just like there's a kerf or a curl to it. I can't even make the board do what it has to do. It'll kind of come out a little bit like that shape. You just let it sit a minute, it'll flatten right back out. But you can see this is flat as a board can be. So you can definitely print both sides, but no problem. So.
Yeah, and just to wrap some context around what Neil was doing today, he was printing in a three-pass mode, which is as fast as we go. And it's really meant for this type of work. But he can print 250 of those signs an hour. Okay, typically you go 10 up on a 4x8 sheet, and he can put a lot of 4x8 sheets in. By the spec, he can put more than 25 through an hour when he hot loads. So again, that's not something that's new to us. Almost 22% of what's printed across the population that have these printers, which is a few hundred users, prints at that mode corrugated. One thing I'd just like to say before I finish my thing, if anybody wants to do a virtual demo of this product, whether you're an iOS user, whether you're a Microsoft person, whether you are an Android type of user, on all three stores, you can find the HP Latex virtual demo. It's free. We don't charge you for it. And if you want to find out anything about this printer, it has a 3D walk around. It's got all the specs. It's got a picture of the edge guards that we talked about today. It's just got a lot of cool stuff in there. So again, this printer is a great printer. As one of my colleagues says, it's the coolest printer on the planet. We love working with it. We love to partner with Grimco. They're our largest partner. Neil does a great job. And I hope everybody gets through this. And we certainly appreciate Grimco hosting this today. So thank you very much.
Perfect. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Neil. We appreciate you both jumping on and all of you guys attending. So the next session is going to be at 1:30 Central Time, and that's on the Epson DTG, which is the direct-to-garment printer. It is the same login as you used for this session. And the following sessions we have is at 3 o'clock, the ESCO, and at 4 o'clock is the Epson S-Series. So feel free, even if you didn't RSVP, you can join back to any of those other sessions. And don't forget, at any time, put anything in the chat and we will connect you with the answers or to the right Grimco person to help you after the call. But thank you both, and we'll be back on soon.
Thanks, Allison.